Assassin's Creed was a one-of-a-kind back then. I have never played a game where it gave me so much freedom to traverse and explore during the time. I was in awe of it all. Of course, the argument that you can't learn from games or that it's not productive playing them is a common one that to this day is still brought up. Well, today, video games are in almost everybody's lives one way or another, whether it's on a TV, monitor, or portable device, including a phone. Even though video games are widely used, it doesn't seem to be widely accepted, or at the very least, people are still extremely cautious about it in terms of learning. Going back to Assassin's Creed, I just kept playing it, enjoying it, and at the end of it, wanting more. In 2009, Assassin's Creed 2 was revealed with the trailer, and after watching it, I immediately fell in love with it. A new character, a different time period, in a different location, and the neat addition of the hidden gun. I waited for what felt like decades to play it. Having the game in hand, it was my only go-to game during the time, and for good reason. From there, I played more games, and during the years, I thought of something.
The bar held a lot of memories.
I decided to go back to Assassin's Creed 2 and challenge the game and myself to see while playing it if the game has something educational to offer, and if I can find it, see if I can use what I learned to life itself. And the first thing I was hit with was this. Suffice to say, I was not enjoying what I was learning and soon stopped reading all these codex screens. It was upsetting, but it certainly didn't stop me from enjoying the beauty of this game. The more I played, the more time I spent meeting interesting individuals, exploring the variety of places I get to visit, including Florence, Venice, Forli, and Tuscany, and also getting to admire the background music played in each city. This was my first game that made me pay more attention to music than any other title I've played before. At times, I would simply walk around a city, looking around and certainly admiring what I was seeing. I would even climb a tall building just to look at the view I had the privilege of viewing. The game is old, sure, but the fact that each city has a small tint does give it a bit of character, like the warm orange in Florence, or the cool blue in Venice. At one point, I started to upgrade the villa and increase its value in order to have better income. Through upgrades, shops were also added around town which showed growth and restoration, having the entire town look better and better through the upgrades purchased. From having a rundown villa with barred windows, to a villa that is properly maintained again. The first time I stumbled upon a glyph was unsettling, like it wasn't meant to be in the game. Everything was dark, and a man was speaking as if he was warning me as a player, rather than Desmond, the protagonist. Glyphs are used as a side activity, with tasking a player to look for pieces of Eden hidden in each painting, and figuring out some puzzles as well. First playing this definitely gave a chill down my spine, but it certainly gave me a reason to start paying attention to where the pieces of Eden could be hiding in these paintings. Over time, I began to look at paintings in the game with a bit of skepticism to see if a piece of Eden was hiding somewhere. However fictitious, Assassin's Creed adding a hidden lore to their world had me ask questions about how much unwritten history there may be out there for our world. History is written by the victors, after all. On the topic of history, codex pages are used for both mechanical and narrative purposes. Mechanical because they unlock new tools and skills from pages like the different techniques of assassination, already mentioned second hidden blade and hidden gun, and the poison blade, as well as increase your maximum health bar. Narrative because you can learn more about Altair, the character you played as in the first title, and progress the story to uncover the Templar plot. Though it's not a necessity for every single person on the planet to know extensively, history can teach us a lot more than just what people were like in the past, but also, as it's shown in Assassin's Creed 2, survival skills, combat techniques, lessons that were passed down from generations, and understanding crucial mistakes people made that led to catastrophic consequences. Assassin's Creed's clear strength is that it allows the player to play with the past, not just by running around in cities, but also meeting notable individuals that help the player accomplish their tasks. Like Leonardo da Vinci helping a player infiltrate a palace by using his famous flying machine, also known as Ornithopter, helping Lorenzo de' Medici eliminate the Templar conspirators that attacked him and his brother, Giuliano, who died during the attack, and helping Caterina Sforza defend Forli against the Orsi brothers who were hired by the Templars, to name some. Through encountering these people, it exposed me to the stories that existed, although altered, that I wouldn't have known otherwise. This also goes to some of the Templars you assassinate, the Pazzi family, and some but not all of the conspirators involved in the assassination attempt against Medici, Marco Barbarigo, and Rodrigo Borgia were individuals who existed during the time and were portrayed accurately enough regarding their age and status while also being believably involved in a Templar order that you as the assassin fight against. The Patti conspiracy is a great example, as not only was the event relatively accurate with who was involved in the attack, but also that Francesco De Patti died in Assassin's Creed 2 in a similar way to how he actually died, hung from the Palazzo Vecchio. Although Assassin's Creed 2 does not portray all events as accurate as what a class on the top can teach you, it does give a glimpse to stories that I certainly would not have paid attention to otherwise, how human people are, no matter the time period. Ezio Auditore is no different. Born into a family involved in a hidden war against the Templars, Ezio becomes surrounded by tragedy and death with no say in the matter, and was certainly not brought upon by his actions. With nothing but anger and confusion, Ezio begins a tale of vengeance that begins a course in the span of 23 years. While the Auditore family was fake, their emotions were not. While yes, this is a game, I personally cannot imagine how I would feel or what I would do if half of my close family died, high-ranking officials were after me, or having my reputation be slandered by false accusations, let alone all of them at the same time while at the age of 17. Ezio becomes an iconic character in gaming history not simply because of how his outfit looks or how he can climb almost any building, although it helps, but it was his character development. From a teen who was driven by vengeance to kill the Templars responsible, to an experienced assassin who moves past vengeance and now fights for himself, and not for his fallen father and brothers. I imagine many of us were told to follow certain professions because it pays well, or that it is a respectable profession to be in. But in the end, it must be us as the individuals to decide our future. There is no golden path or the perfect way to live life because in the end, everything will have consequences, both directly and indirectly. We must commit to our actions and decisions for our own reasons and not for others. To do so in someone's honor is commendable, but can be debilitating. To listen to advice is helpful, but can be crippling. That being said, to treat yourselves every day is rewarding, but can be self-destructive. Like I said, no golden path.
But it is our ability to choose whatever you think is true that makes us human.
Even though video games are widely used, it doesn't seem to be widely accepted, or at the very least, people are still extremely cautious about it in terms of learning. And after this small experiment with a game I remember dearly, I can confidently say that video games have the capacity to not only create emotional journeys and engage individuals, but have moments of reflection and inspiration that any good storyteller can conjure. This is not to say that video games are the best art form or that Assassin's Creed 2 is a perfect game for an extremely captivating story. There are games that do better storytelling, but that it demonstrates a clear ability to move individuals as effectively as any other form like movies, books, or paintings, with a different method, through play. So the next time you play a game with a gripping story, try to find out what it is about it that makes it amazing for you. And if possible, comment if there was something that you learned from playing or replaying that game. Who knows, it could be the same game others have played but not have noticed. Before you go and enjoy your day, I wanted to thank you for watching this short video essay of mine. I did this to know what it's like to make a video for the first time, and it felt fulfilling to finally release this for you to enjoy. I can't say when's the next time I'll make another video, or if it'll be longer than this one, but I can say that once I do begin my next project, I'll aim to make it either the same quality or better than the one you just watched. So until then, stay safe, look both ways before crossing the road, and I hope to hear from you soon.